church sins against me, how often should I forgive? As many as 7 times? Jesus said to him, not 7 times, but I tell you, 77 times. For this reason, the kingdom of heaven has been compared to a king who wished to settle accounts with his slaves. When he began the reckoning, one who owed him 10,000 talents was brought to him. And as he could not pay, his Lord ordered him to be sold, together with his wife and children and all his possessions, and payment to be made. So the slave fell on his knees before him, saying, have patience with me, and I will pay you everything. And out of pity for him, the Lord of that slave released him and forgave him the debt. But that same slave, as he went out, came upon one of his fellow slaves who owed 100 denarii. Seizing him by the throat, he said, pay what you owe. Then his fellow slave fell down and pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will pay you. But he refused. Then he went and threw him into prison until he could pay the debt. When his fellow slaves saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their lord all that had taken place. Then his lord summoned him and said to him, you wicked slave, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. Should you not have had mercy on your fellow slave as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his lord handed him over to be tortured until he would pay his entire debt. So my heavenly Father will also do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother or sister from your heart. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. We will all stand before the judgment seat of God. There, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall give praise to God. There, each of us will be accountable to God. So says the Apostle Paul in this morning's reading from Romans. What do you hear in these words of Scripture? Law or gospel? Good news or a wake-up call about where your life may be headed? We will all stand before the judgment seat of God, where each of us will be accountable to God. Paul writes these words in the middle of urging members of the church not to judge one another for how they live out their faith in their daily lives. It seems that some folks in the early church were vegetarians, while others were meat eaters. Go figure. But each group disparaged the other as weak in faith. Some folks regarded one day to be better than another, preference perhaps to Sabbath keeping from sundown Friday to sundown Saturday, while others treated every day the same, which was the dominant cultural practice in the ancient world. But of course, again, each group labeled the other as weak in faith. Yet, as Paul points out, all of these practices are done by believers trying to honor the Lord and give thanks to God. Let me give you a more modern example. There's a story about Ruth Graham, the wife of the famous evangelist Billy Graham. Apparently, during a visit to Germany in the 1970s, Mrs. Graham had lunch with the wives of some evangelical pastors. As the meal progressed, a German pastor's wife burst into tears, crying right into her glass of beer. Why? It turns out that she was upset and angry because Mrs. Graham was wearing mascara. In her opinion, a very shameful and worldly practice unbecoming a serious Christian. Mrs. Graham, who had no idea her mascara was a problem for these evangelical women, for her part, was deeply disturbed that a pastor's wife would drink beer at lunch. Yes, we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, where each of us will be accountable to there are four characters in this parable. The king, the unforgiving slave, the second slave, and a group of fellow slaves. All of these characters are bound together in a hierarchically organized community designed to ensure the continuous flow of wealth, power, and honor to the king. That's how ancient societies were organized. The unforgiving slave is a managerial slave whose debt represents the income he is expected to gather from those under his management and pass along to the master. The amount owed is astronomical, equivalent to 150,000 years of labor, which realistically neither he nor his community would ever be able to pay. On the day of reckoning, the king forgives this massive debt, just writes it off. Now, this is not a private, personal act of debt forgiveness between the king and the slave. It is a debt amnesty for an entire community. The unforgiving slave is supposed to pass it along, but he barely gets out the door before he reverts to business as usual, assaulting the second slave, demanding payment of 100 denarii, the equivalent of 100 days of labor. 150,000 years versus 100 days of labor, and throws him into prison for non-payment. The unforgiving slave's actions are no more private and personal than the king's, and the community brings the matter to the king, who now judges the unforgiving slave according to the unforgiving slave's own standards. Not a surprise. This is what Jesus told his disciples would happen in the Sermon on the Mount. He teaches them that with what judgment you judge, you will be judged, and the measure you give will be the measure you get back. As the arrow in the diagram highlights, what goes around comes around. Now, Jesus tells this story in response to Peter's question. Lord, if my brother sins against me, should I forgive? As many as seven times? See, Peter wants a number, a quantifiable standard by which to reckon if he measures up to what is expected and required of a disciple. Jesus' response, that not seven times, it's actually 70 times seven, 490 times, is immediately followed by this story about this slave who is in bondage to counting, calculating, and keeping track of what everyone owes him. Jesus' response is not intended to get Peter to increase his forgiveness quota, but to get him to stop counting. No counting. Imagine that Peter had asked, Lord, how often should I love my neighbor? Seven times. How can we quantify or count love? As an expression of love, forgiveness cannot be counted or calculated either. As Martin Luther King Jr. famously said, forgiveness is not an occasional act. It is a constant attitude. Forgiveness is an attitude marked by two things. First, the acceptance that you cannot change the past. It's over and done. And secondly, the realization that the past does not have to hold you captive. See, forgiveness does not change our past, but it does open us up to a new and different future. Without forgiveness, we remain captive to the past, bound by the hurts we have received and the hurts we've caused. We remain in bondage to our mistakes, our regrets, and our inability to let go. We will all stand before the judgment seat of God, where each of us will be accountable to God. And as one of the elderly members at Prairie Hills reminded me this week, the good news is that our judge God is pleased to reconcile all things in heaven and earth. Yes, indeed, we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, where every knee shall bow and every tongue shall give praise to God, saying something like, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless God's holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, for all God's benefits to me, forgiving all my sins, healing all my hurts, redeeming me from the grave, crowning me with steadfast love and mercy, satisfying my desires with good things, and giving me renewed life. Bless the Lord, O my soul, for vindicating and providing justice for the oppressed. Bless the Lord, O my soul, for you, O God, are full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. As far as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is your steadfast love for all your children. Bless the Lord, O my soul, for you, God, have not dealt with me according to my sins, nor repaid me according to my iniquities. As far as the east is from the west, so far have you removed my transgressions from me." Now that's forgiveness. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand as you